suffering in a temple and embers and death. Quickly realize number.
Testing, testing. Oh, okay.
Okay, yeah.
This is the main mic. Okay. Okay, so sorry. Maybe a little bit too loud. Please turn to page two, which is the title of our sutra. So here we're going to invoke the names of the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, as well as the sutra itself. And the spirit is that it's a kind of invitation, so we can invite the presence of the sutra. It's on page two, which is the Roman numeral two. The II, for those who are not into Roman numerals. II. Okay, and so we'll recite the sutra's title name and the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas associated with it. And if we kind of have in our heart this sense of invitation, who knows, maybe the Bodhisattvas actually do come. So, okay. No, that means. Namo da fang guang fo hua yen jing hua yen ai wei fo bu zai namo da fang guang fo hua yen jing hua yen ai wei fo bu zai namo da vang vang vo hua yen jing hua yen ai wei fo bu zai namo da vang vang vo hua yen jing hua yen ai wei fo bu zai namo
da vang wang wo wa yin jing wa yin ai wei bo bu dai na mo da vang wang wo wa yin jing wa yin ai wei bo bu dai na mo da vang wang wo wa yin jing wa yin ai wei bo bu dai.
Okay, so good evening, everybody. Welcome to Berkeley Buddhist Monastery. Today is July 11th, 2015, and we're going to begin our Avatamsaka Sutra lecture, or on the book in front of you, I should say, the Great Flower Garland Scripture of the Buddha's Expanded Mahayana Teachings. And this is another name for the sutra called the Avatamsaka in Sanskrit. So I believe people who were here last week heard from Reverend Hung Shur that he's going to be away for a while, a number of months. Right now he's actually in Malaysia with Jing Hoshur. And so Jing Hoshur and myself will be doing this lecture and the next lecture. But he will be back on the screen after that. So he'll continue lecturing the sixth ground Avatamsaka Sutra, or the 10 grounds chapter, the sixth ground, which he's on right now, of the Avatamsaka Sutra. And so we thought, rather than trying to go back and forth, and be a little bit confusing, we thought, what would be kind of in continuation of the Avatamsaka spirit, maybe give people a bit of a summary, some background, some principle to help give context to also the 10 grounds chapter that we're going over with Reverend Hung Shur. And so there's one chapter, which is this one, called the 10 Practices chapter. Just in terms of a raise of hands, how many people actually have, Reverend Hung Shur actually lectured this before, so I was just wondering how many people were actually here when he did this one? Anybody? I was actually here when he did it, and I actually found it very, very inspiring. At that time, it was probably like 7 years ago? I was for sure a layman at the time. And I came to the monastery, and I remember this particular text was very inspiring. And Reverend Hung Shur himself was so inspired by it during the Three Steps, One Bow journey that he really tried to memorize the entire text. I don't think he said he finished it, but he got pretty far into memorizing it. And he said it was really helpful for him in this Three Steps, One Bow pilgrimage, this particular text, which is why he translated it, and we have this kind of preliminary translation version that's here. And what you see is basically the Bodhisattva's spirit with the 10 paramitas, which has the exact same parallel with the 10 grounds. You know, the 10 grounds, the first ground is the ground of happiness, which here is the first ground is the practice of happiness, and is the perfection of giving, which is the first paramita. So you'll see it, the 10 practices on the back cover of your sutra text, right? And so for me, I remember listening to it, and it was very inspiring back when I was a layman, quite a few years ago, and I thought, well, with Jing Forsher, we thought, well, this would be a really good text to continue on with, because it's such a, I think, a very approachable text. What you'll find is there's a lot of stories, a lot of examples, and a lot of practices that are given for the paramitas, and so it's something that I think is very nice to study. So that's a little bit of the context for how we ended up choosing this particular chapter. In terms of the Avatamsaka Sutra, the Avatamsaka Sutra is a really big sutra. I think people who've seen it on the wall, I don't think we just have the Avatamsaka there behind us. It's the whole Tripitaka behind us. But if you look at the one that we published by DRBA, that has a little bit of larger font with pinyin, the books are maybe this big, this thick, and then it fills up about this much. There's an 80 roll version, which is what we're using. And basically, it's a very long sutra. with lots of different sections in it. And it describes the path of the bodhisattvas, the cultivation of a bodhisattva. And in the beginning has all the theory about what to do. And then afterwards, on chapter 39, which is a very long chapter, it talks about a young boy named Sudana, which Reverend Sher also lectured on, Sudana, who takes the journey on the bodhisattva path to become a Buddha. So it has like kind of like an epic journey of somebody actually walking the path. So part of it's theory and part of the actual, you could say, story of somebody doing it. And so what we're in the beginning part, within the 10 grounds chapter, as well as the 10 practices, is the kind of quote-unquote the theory part. And so we can imagine we're taking in the theory to try to walk the path ourselves. And how it works is that they say there's about 52 levels on the bodhisattva path. I think in different sutras they say different number. I think the Sharangama had like 57 or something. But here there's 52 in the Avatamsaka. And the levels go starting with, we call them the 10 faiths. That's the first 10 stages of the bodhisattva path, followed by the 10 practices, which is this one, followed by the, okay, let me see my memory. 10 faiths, 10 practices, 10 transferences. Oh, no, we missed one. 10 faiths, 10 dwellings, 10 practices, 10 transferences, and then the 10 grounds. So that makes 50, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 grounds. And then we have two more, which they say is, quote unquote, translated as equal enlightenment, and then wondrous enlightenment. And that's the state of the Buddhas, is wondrous enlightenment. That's why, I don't know if that's why, but that's one reference point. You know, the city of 10,000 Buddhas, the mountain behind the city of 10,000 Buddhas is called Wondrous Enlightenment Mountain, right? You know, Drusen. And so that's the reference there. It's basically the final stage of the becoming a Buddha is wondrous enlightenment. So this is, you can see, the stages of the bodhisattva walking the path. So we're on, you can say, level 31 with the 10 practices chapter. And we're for sure doing the 10 ground, or yeah, the 10 grounds is on level like 46. I guess this would be 21, and then that would be 36. Depends how you count them, right? And so we're in the beginning phase of that. And so the sutras, the Avatamsaka is very complete. So the number is always 10. It goes through 10 of everything. And the idea is it's a very round number. And when you kind of get the principles 10 times, it kind of goes into your mind in a very complete way. And so we're doing the 10 practices chapter for these the following two lectures, and then we'll see how the cause and conditions work out. But this is a very wonderful text, and it's very well translated as well. Okay. So if you like, you can open the page to page, the real page one with the actual number one on it. It says the great flower garland scripture of the Buddha's expanded Mahayana teachings, chapter 21, the 10 practices. Okay. So how we start with the sutra lecture is we read the Chinese first together, and then we read the English, or we read the Chinese, and then you repeat after, I think Jingfo should read the Chinese, and you can repeat after him, and then we'll read the English together. And so we'll read about 2.5 pages to the middle of page 3. So that's the time. So people who haven't had any Chinese background, it's an interesting opportunity to kind of look at those strange characters on the left side of the page, which are supposed to be some of them kind of pictographs. They kind of look like the actual image, the actual thing that it's being described. But underneath it, there is Romanization. So you can try to follow the Romanization. Jingfo Shi will give the Chinese pronunciations. When you say it, you can kind of try to catch the right intonation. The other thing that's a little bit tricky is that there's these little things above the characters, like a hook or an arrow going up. Those are called tones. And so in Chinese, the tones actually matter. So if you say, for instance, the classic is ma, 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 all sound the same in English,
but they mean very different things. One means mother, one means horse, one means scolding somebody, you know, so you want to make sure you get the right word. So the tones are basically one tone, which the first one is like this going like a check, go down and then up. The one that goes up is just you go up. The flat one is flat. The down is a down sound. It's like you're kind of angry at somebody, down. So that's those are the tones of the language. Okay. Jing Foshu's tones are much better than mine. Since I grew up here in America, my tones are all wrong. So it'd be better if Jing Foshu reads it.
How, 大家可以跟着一起念, 我这样子还是依照 司法师的，我念一句， 大家跟着一句， 这样子大家可以看到这个发音会比较正确。 OK， 好， 我们开始从第一页。 尔时功德林菩萨，
尔时功德林菩萨，
成佛神力，
成佛神力，
入菩萨善思维三昧，
入菩萨善思维三昧，
入世三昧仪，
入世三昧仪，
十方各万佛刹，
十方各过万佛刹，
very good， 微尘数世界外，
微尘数世界外，
有万佛刹，
有万佛刹，
微尘数诸佛，
微尘数诸佛，
皆号功德林，
皆号功德林，
而现其前，
而现其前，
告功德林菩萨言，
告功德林菩萨言。
OK, page 2 或者是 English?
Okay, you read English.
Yeah, English.
Together? Okay. At that time, forest of merit and virtue, Bodhisattva, received the Buddha's spiritual power and entered the Bodhisattva's skillful contemplation samadhi. After entering this samadhi, in each of the 10 directions from worlds countless as fine particles in a myriad Buddha lands, or Buddhas as many as fine particles in a myriad Buddha lands, all of whom were named forest of merit and virtue, all of them appeared before him and spoke these words to forest of merit and virtue, Bodhisattva.
好，第二页， 善哉佛子，
善哉佛子，
乃能入此善思维三昧，
能入此善思维三昧，
善男子，
善男子，
此事十方，
此事十方，
各万佛刹，
各万佛刹，
微尘数同名诸佛，
微尘数同名诸佛，
共加于汝，
共加于汝，
以是毗卢遮那如来，
以是毗卢遮那如来，
往昔愿力，
往昔愿力，
威神之力，
威神之力，
及诸菩萨众善根力，
及诸菩萨众善根力，
令汝入世三昧，
令汝入世三昧，
而演说法，
而演说法。
Okay, English.
Okay. Good indeed, disciples of the Buddha, that you can enter this skillful contemplation samadhi. Good man, this is conferred upon you by all of these Buddhas in each of the 10 directions, in number like fine particles in 10,000 Buddha lands, who bear the same name. It also due to the power of the past vows of Vairochana Tathagata and to his awesome spiritual strength, as well as to the power of the assembled bodhisattvas' roots of goodness, that you can enter this samadhi and proclaim the Dharma.
Okay. 好, 再继续。 为增长佛智故，
为身入法界故，了知众生界故，守入无碍故，所行无障故，得无量方便故。
舍取一切自性故，
觉悟一切诸法故，
知一切诸根故，能持说一切法故，所谓。发起诸菩萨十种恨，善男子，汝当成佛为神之力，而言此法。
Okay, English. In order to grow in the Buddha's wisdom.In order to enter deeply the Dharma realm, in order to understand the realm of beings, in order to become unobstructed, in order to be unhindered in cultivation, in order to obtain measureless expedience, in order to gather back the nature of all wisdom, in order to enlighten to all dharmas, in order to know all faculties, and in order to uphold and speak all dharmas,That is to say, in order to begin the 10 kinds of practices of all bodhisattvas. Good man, you should receive the Buddha's awesome spiritual power and proclaim this Dharma.
各位还不要翻走, don't want to move. You can see page 2, the bottom 2 line, the first, 行无障故。And also, you can see the, 这个第三页的 so two same words, but different pronouns. One pronouns, 行, another pronouns, 恨. Yeah, 恨 and 行 is the same word, but the pronouns different. So this is a little bit, we need to pay attention that. Like tonight, 我们今天晚上十恨品，我们是讲念恨，不是念十行，所以有一点点不一样的念法。
This is just to make Chinese a little even more complicated. Which line? I mean, I'll explain. So just to make it even more complicated, Jin Forsher is saying, I'll point out even more clearly. So.We see on the front cover, it says here, 10. So that first character is 10. And that word, what Jing Foshu is mentioning, is Xing or Hun. So there's two ways of pronouncing this character, depending in the context. And so here, we usually say it's the Si Hun Ping. So when we're talking about this particular text, we're saying it's Hun. We don't say Xing. If you want to look at the image, actually, it's an image of 2 feet. I don't know how you get 2 feet exactly, but...It's supposed to be 1 foot, the other foot, left to right, left to right. And also is the word for cultivation. You see when we talk about cultivation, people hear the words shouxing, people are in the monastery, right? Shouxing, that's the character there too. So here's the si hen ping, and then also shouxing. And then also pu xian hen yuan, which is the Samantabhadra's practices and vows chapter, which we just did in Buddha Root Farm. So this is one character you can probably learn. It's not too difficult, right? It's got a little thing on the side and a little thing on the left and right. So, yeah. That comes up a lot. It's worth learning.
好，今天我们大家在这里研究华严经的这个十恨品，它是在二十一品，它是属于《华严经》的第四会，就是 那佛陀讲《幻经》，他有很多，总共有六会，那这个是第四会。那第四会，他是在夜摩天宫讲的。夜摩天宫，那夜摩天宫在哪里？就在西弥山顶，在西弥山顶。
So this particular chapter is spoken by the Buddha, and it's spoken on the you say we call it various assemblies, meaning various gatherings. So there's a total of six different gatherings in the Avatamsaka Sutra. So the Buddha went to six different places to speak. And so this one is happening at the fourth place. And the fourth place where the Buddha's at is the Yama Heaven. Sometimes also translated as Suyama Heaven. So the Suyama Heaven's actually at the top of Mount Sumeru. So if you look at Buddhist cosmology, it's one of the higher heavens.
Mm. 有52个阶段，那这个十住十恨十回向，它这个是三贤位，啊，然后啊修完以后修十地的话，就是十地品，像师法师现在在讲，我们都讲到第六地了，那是十圣位，哎，一个三贤位，一个十圣位，这个啊是。 菩萨的一个修行一个顺序，就这样子的话，总共再加上实性，就总共有五十位，然后加等觉妙觉，就是52位。那这个要修三大阿僧祇劫。
So as been said before, the Bodhisattva path is consists of 52 different stages. And so there's the 30 stages, which is the 10 dwellings, the 10 practices, and the 10 transferences. They're actually considered the three worthy stages, you could say. If people look at the Amitabha Sutra, the Amitabha praise in the evening, right before the praise, we say that may all the ghosts and spirits attain the three worthy stages. That's actually what it's referring to. So now you can make a link. Oh, that's what I'm saying. The other one is the 10 grounds then. It's actually the 10 sagely, there's 10 positions of the sages as well. So we also say that, I believe, in the Amitabha praise right before. So now you know where that refers to. So we're actually hoping all the ghosts and spirits and all living beings, you know, walk the Bodhisattva path. So basically we have the 30 stages and before, the three worthy stages, and then the 10 grounds, which is Reverend Hongshu is speaking about. So that makes a total of 40. And then plus the 10, which is in the very beginning, which is the 10 faiths, and that makes 50, plus the two more, which is equal enlightenment and wondrous enlightenment. So that makes the entire Bodhisattva path. And this whole process takes, it said, three great Asamkhya eons to cultivate, to walk that path.
好像非常要修行很久，但是佛法是心修，就慢慢往前走，往前步行出去，所以要有长远心，修行是很重要，除了说精进，要有长远心。
In terms of the, you hear the word three great Asamkhya eons, that seems like a long time. But in cultivation, we need to look long. We need to have this persevering mind and look long. We want to be vigorous, but in addition to being vigorous, we also want to be in for the long haul. We want to be able to constantly persevere, slowly move forward step by step, you know, just consistently keep going forward.
我们还是从遗照书本上来解释这个经文，这样子会比较不离开我们的主题。我们看从头开始好了。尔时功德林菩萨，哦，曾 佛神力入菩萨善思维三昧，这个功德林菩萨，从字面上是可以知道他，菩萨他修很多的功德，修到就是说好像树林一样的那么多，哎，但是他成佛神力，这个这句非常重要，成佛神力就是他要，因为今天晚上的这个十恨品是他以他为说法主，但是他说法也是非常谦虚，成佛的这个力量来说法。上人一直也是强调我们修行要很谦虚，他也是非常谦虚，他虽然修了很多，但是他还是一样的要尊重佛的智慧来说这个法。当然这个后面我们等一下还会讲到，因为他很谦虚，所以就会很多的佛菩萨来加持他。
So here we will go to actually reading the sutra text, so we will be able to stay within the spirit of the sutra. And so here the sutra says, at that time, forest of merit and virtue, Bodhisattva received the Buddha's spiritual power and entered the Bodhisattva's skillful contemplation samadhi. So forest of merit and virtue Bodhisattva. So from his name, we can say this Bodhisattva cultivated a great deer of merit and virtue, making a forest of merit and virtue. And in addition to that, it says the next line, which is very important, which is that he received the Buddha's spiritual power to, because what forest of merit and virtue Bodhisattva will do is he's going to speak the Dharma. And so he's very humble, and it basically says that he's relying on the Buddha's strength to gain support, so that when he speaks the Dharma, he has the Buddha's wisdom to support him, spiritual power to support him. And so this is a very important principle that's very Master Hua always emphasized, which is when we cultivate, we need to be very humble. So although Forest of Merit and Virtue Bodhisattva has cultivated a great deal, he still, or she still, is very humble and relies on the Buddha's strength. It's not that they just kind of develop pride. And so this will go on to be spoken about more, because later he receives the spiritual support from all the various Buddhas as well as the Bodhisattvas in his cultivation.
好，再继续看经文啊。成佛神力以后，入菩萨善思维三昧。这个入菩萨善思维三昧是你知道三昧就是禅定，那善思维就是一种上人解释是最好的三昧。那这个华严这个书论里面也有讲，就是善思维的意思就是巧顺事理，简择无碍，无心成事。他这样子叫做善思维，因为这个是一个因为菩萨他能够入这个定的话，他就是能不再做作，然后就随缘，然后随事理要怎样子，他都能够无所障碍都能够办好度众生的这个成这个事。这个是善思维三昧，像这个善思维三昧当然三昧有很多种，我们在实力品也讲过，其实就是最好的三昧。
刚刚那句是怎么解释？
巧顺事理，就是说你在解释这个。
对，
好，我解释一下了，就是说你能够善巧顺理一些事情，它的理体都一样，然后他能够他自己能够没有障碍的，他要选择怎样子怎样子，都自己都非常的自如，然后这样子，因为他无心做作，因为他就能够成就，就是不因为你一有心就不对了，所以这个是修行的一种，就是 所以他都能够成就度化众生的这个事情，也是他的愿力。
Okay, so it's, okay. So the next one talks about the Bodhisattva entering the skillful contemplation samadhi. Master Hua describes this samadhi as the very best samadhi. But another commentary says Qingliang Guo Si. So from National Master Qingliang, also known as the Avatamsaka Bodhisattva, he describes this skillful contemplation samadhi as being one where you're able to be skillful in according with all living beings, what they like, in all situations, whatever arises, you know what to do, and you're doing it just right. And at the same time, you have no obstructions when you do anything. Everything just goes really smoothly. And so this is why is this? Is because Bodhisattva has no attachments and is free from thought. He has no attachment to his thoughts. He's completely free. And he's able to cultivate in this way so that he's able to, transform living beings. He can be successful in his efforts to transform living beings. Good job, teacher. So I just want to say maybe a couple words, but we'll get into more later. But I think a couple of things are important here to be mindful of. One is that second line that Jing Forster mentioned about relying on the Buddha's spiritual power. We'll get into more of it later, but I think this is actually very important for cultivation, because oftentimes we sometimes think that spiritual practice is somehow just relying on ourselves. We sometimes hear there is a line from the Pali text, which is true. And the Buddha says at the end of his life, he says what? Do you know? Anybody? The Buddha's entering nirvana, and he and the monks are all gathered together, and what does the Buddha tell the monks? Yeah, be an island unto yourself, with no other island, no other place as your refuge, and take the Dharma as your refuge. So you be an island unto yourself, and also rely on the Dharma in your practice. And he was saying that don't rely on me, right? Don't rely on me, because I'm passing away. So how does that make sense with this particular line, which talks about he received the spiritual power of the Buddha? I think that spirit of kind of do it yourself, I don't need to rely on anybody else, I can just cultivate on my own, at least in America, I don't know if it's generally true in all Western culture, but at least in America, I think it's very much the spirit, kind of like, I'm going to do it myself. I'm not going to need anybody else to do it. And so that's appealing to us. And that's very, I think, a very, in some ways, a very wholesome aspiration, that we want to put the teachings into practice ourselves and really make it work. You know, it's a kind of do-it-yourself spirit. But at the same time, if we look at the scriptures here, it's not completely a solo journey. It's something where we're actually in relationship with teachers here, with the Buddha, to give us guidance and support. And so although in that particular sutra, or that the sutta, the Nirvana Sutta, it talks about how the Buddha says, you know, rely on yourselves. But right before that, and earlier in that text, he actually talks about how to have the whole Sangha, all the monastic community, be in harmony with another to cultivate together. So you have to read the texts in their entire context, in a way. And you'll see that the Buddha consistently offers spiritual companions on the journey. Either teachers that are in front to give us guidance and support, fellow cultivators on our left and right, you know, people behind us to lead us and or to inspire us to move forward, or kind of force us to move forward so that we have to give some instructions. So we go, okay, I've got to learn something now. And that's the spirit. And so within the Buddha Dharma, within this particular text, you can see it immediately that for us, the merit and virtue Bodhisattva, even at such a high stage of cultivation, he's relying on the Buddha's strength. So I think in general, we don't want to push away the Buddha's teachings or the Buddha's strength and say, I can just do it myself. Rather, if we invite that energy in to be supported, that really helps us in our cultivation. You know, say, okay, I will rely on the Buddha's wisdom and support, and I can cultivate. In the Sharangama Sutra, there's actually a story that I really, really like because it's so concrete. And it says, this is a great string Bodhisattva's cultivation method to perfection, to enlightenment. And what was it?
people who read the Sri Rangma probably know. He says he recited Amitabha Buddha's name, which is what we're going to do next weekend, right? Amitabha Buddha's name. And he said, and let me explain to you how this works. He said, it's like a mother who's lost her son. And the son ran far away, and she's always thinking about the son and wants to help the son. But the son, being a little bit disobedient, probably a little bit rebellious, grew up in here in America, like myself, and we kind of like don't want to be with our family, and just does his own thing, forgets about the mom entirely. And he says, well, what can the mom do? Can't do too much. But if the son can remember the mom and constantly be mindful of her, then the mother and the son can be reconnected, and they can support, she can support him and help him on the spiritual path. So similarly, the Buddha is like, you say in this analogy, the mother, who's always thinking about their child, always thinking about the kid. And us, which are the kids, are always running away, forgetting about the Buddha. So if we can remember the Buddha, then we can actually connect with that energy, and then they can help. So that's the spirit. So for us, I think that's what we can do in our spiritual practice, is when we recite the Buddha's name or we do the various practices, to actually invite the presence and help of the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. And in the Avatamsaka Sutra, we get this kind of vision that's much grander than our own limited perspective about time and space, and this person's here and I'm here, and then this reality is just this room. It's something that's much grander. And so if we can say, well, maybe there's some truth to this, then if we open our hearts to that energy, we might be supported by something we don't really understand. It's very good and very, very wonderful.
这个成佛威力是不可思议的。我们虽然坐在这里，其实我们大家就是华人海会的一员，然后在听法，在修行，这个是等于如同当时的一样的。我们在研究它，我想佛菩萨都是在加持我们。 这个一样的道理，我想这个是不可否认的。另外，我想刚才提到这个三昧，像我们修行在这里有早晚都在打坐参禅，就这个都是在修定，这个我们修习佛法的。 戒定慧这个定，定以后能够生慧。当然，三年他也一直强调我们修行啊。我记得三年有提过，要我们能够做一行三昧。这个一行三昧，这个就是说，什么叫一行三昧？就是说我们的一行就是很简单的，我们的口跟我们的心能够。
意志的时候，就是你们讲话，你心里面讲什么，你口讲就讲出来。这个是口直心直，这个修行很重要，不要歪掉的话，就会你心想这样子口讲不对，那变成会歪掉，会得不好的果。所以直心是道场，他一直强调我们。 我记得就是说，我们勉励我们，要执心，什么事情修行啊？我们现在虽然还没有得到什么善事为最好的上面，但是我们从一行上面开始修行，就是口跟心能够一致，这样子很简单，一步一步去做。我想这个是对我们，非常重要。他还强调我们，不管什么时候行住坐卧，都是要这样子来做。所以，特别。
So another principle. Okay, so yes, it's actually very inconceivable. The Buddha's awesome spiritual power is very inconceivable and is always blessing us. And here we're all together in this assembly, and in some ways it's just like the Avatamsaka assembly as well. It's just similar to what the sutra is describing. We're all here together to study the Dharma. And
we're sure that the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas are probably also here to bless all of us. We're here listening and investigating the sutra, the Avatamsaka Sutra. When it comes to discussing about samadhi, the cultivation of samadhi is very important. And here in the monastery, we do it every morning and every evening. We do 2 meditation sits. But in the sutras and the Dharma, it often talks about how you cultivate precepts, which helps you to cultivate samadhi, which allows you to develop wisdom. And Master Hua also speaks about one type of samadhi, which I think is also very valuable for everybody to cultivate, to start from, which is this kind of Yixing Sanmei, this kind of one single mind samadhi. And how this works is what your mind or what your heart thinks or feels is what your mouth says. It's like the line is straight, you know. And when you say something, you say what's in your heart, and it's straightforward and not crooked. You don't say you don't think one thing, then you kind of say something else with your mouth that's a little bit deviant or flattery or something to get something. So your mind and what you say is very straight. So there's a saying that says, the straight mind is the way place, or the straight mind is the monastery or your place of cultivation. So if our mind can always be straight and, you know, proper, then we're always in a wholesome environment, basically. And this is something we can do in all times and all places. So they say the 4 positions in Buddhism, and the 4 positions are sitting, standing, walking, and lying down. So can you think of any other position you could be in? Those are the 4 positions. So sitting, I guess if you're running, I'd probably be walking. So basically, those 4 positions, which is all the time, every moment of your day, is when you can practice this. Maybe just to add something, just to make a note. So it doesn't mean that whatever comes into your mind, you should say it. It's not like straight in the sense of like, oh, whatever I think of, therefore I should just say whatever I need to say just because I thought of it. That's not quite how it works, because you can end up offending a lot of people. So you need to be skillful in your speech. But skillful is basically being sensitive and aware of what's the environment, so you can say what's appropriate. But when you're saying having a straight mind and straight speech, is basically we don't say something to kind of manipulate something for our own benefit, you know, or we say something just out of habit because, you know, we're jealous of somebody else, or we're resentful toward somebody, or they say something to us in a certain way, so then we kind of say something back in a harsh way. So those would be all ways of using the mouth wrong. And it's, you know, although our mind has this feeling of aversion and hatred, it's not to say, oh, therefore it's a straight, I can just straightly say what I'm going to say. It's basically you wash the mind and you try to make it, you know, straight, as in proper. And then when you say something, you really mean it. You know, you're really sincere. But when I say this, I'm really sincere. I really mean what I'm saying. It's very truthful. It's very thoughtful. It's very sincere. If you say it with some humility, that's really good. So that's the straight mind.
OK, 在下面看后半段，第一页后半段，如是三昧以十方过万佛刹，微尘世世界外有万佛刹，微尘世诸佛，皆号功德林。所以这个就是讲十方的诸佛，那么多佛刹里面。 有那么多的功德林诸佛，就最好功德林就是功德林佛，所以这个是一个功德林佛，当然也有多现在他的前面，来告示功德林菩萨。
Okay, so the next section of the sutra says, after entering this samadhi in each of the 10 directions from worlds countless as fine particles in a myriad Buddha lands, were Buddhas, as many as fine particles in a myriad Buddha lands, all of whom were named Forest of Merit and Virtue. All of them appeared before him and spoke these words to Forest of Merit and Virtue Bodhisattva. So here you see all these Buddhas appearing. They all share the same name as this Bodhisattva. So I thought this is actually also very interesting, kind of unexpected. You know, if you read the
read a text, all of a sudden, all these Buddhas appear with the same name, right? It's like, huh, that's kind of interesting if you kind of imagine, if you were just kind of think about this being like a movie and you have this Bodhisattva ready to teach, and all of a sudden all these other Buddhas appear with the same name. But usually you think, you know, the Buddha's kind of one name, one Buddha, and having the same name somehow kind of confuses things. You kind of get them all mixed up. But here, all these Buddhas share the same name as this Bodhisattva and come to speak to him. So I thought, what this reflects, maybe in terms of a principle, is actually what's in a name. You know, what, when we get named, we mostly get pretty attached to our name, right? If somebody says our name, we go, what's happening, right? We kind of pay attention. You know, if somebody says something bad about that name, we pay attention. If somebody says something good about them, well, and just the name. If they just change that name to something else, some other name, a whole different experience happens, right? We names for us are really important because they bring up a lot of feelings and experiences for us because we identify with them. However, for the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, I think they interact with names very differently. They don't hold on to their name and get really defensive about it. I remember one Dharma friend was a little bit upset because they actually had a Dharma name they got from, you know, taking refuge, and they found out somebody they kind of didn't like had the same Dharma name. It's like, oh, that's this person they don't like has the same name as I do. So it's not quite the spirit of what we're about. Right, the Buddha and the Bodhisattvas, I think they're very happy to share their names with one another and encourage one another in the spiritual path. And so this name is also a very interesting name. It says merit and forest of merit and virtue, which for me is a kind of an interesting imagery. You can just imagine the forest and all that being merit and virtue. However, the interesting principle is a little bit on the flip side is oftentimes there's another saying in Buddhism that says that people can kind of guess what gets rid of a forest of merit and virtue. Yeah, one thought of anger. They say what burns up a forest of merit and virtue is one thought of anger. One thought of anger, all the merit and virtue disappears. So I'm sure this Bodhisattva probably has no anger, so that's why he can keep his forest of merit and virtue. So if in the future we want to have, you know, that name, forest of merit and virtue, then if we never get angry, then bit by bit our merit and virtue can grow. You know, they can keep growing.
好，我们进入第二页的第二页 ，second page。Next，yeah，善哉佛子乃能入此善思维三昧。善哉佛子就说：“哦，好啊，这个佛子就是讲功德林菩萨，能够入这个善思维三昧。”他这个后面是就是讲为什么这样子，因为善男子。 此是十方过万佛刹，微尘数同名诸佛，共加一组。就刚才讲的，功德林菩萨都是同一个名字的，都是已经成佛了，功德林佛来加持他。然后也是毗卢遮那如来，就是毗卢遮那佛，毗卢遮那佛就是我们释迦牟尼佛的法身。 以前的法身，他因为往昔的愿力，也这个也是他往昔成佛的时候，他发的愿，就是愿力要来加持这个功德林菩萨，他威神势力及诸菩萨众善根力，令汝入此三昧而演说法，所以不只是佛菩萨，还有。 所有的菩萨，还有所有的菩萨也都来加持他，来用他的修行的这个善根，来都能够令加持这个功德林菩萨来演说这个妙法。我们今天晚上这个十恨品的这个法，所以真的。 就是他要讲这个法，所有的都会来护法，同名的功德林佛以及其他的诸佛以及所有的菩萨都会来加持他，所以这个是非常。 佛法不可思议的事情。
Okay, so the on page 2, starting on page 2, it starts with good indeed. So this is a phrase that's often used in the sutras, which means really, really, really good. You know, so we always say good indeed, excellent, wonderful. And then he praises, these Buddhas praise this Bodhisattva, saying, disciple of the Buddha, you can enter this skillful contemplation samadhi. So good job, you can enter this samadhi. This is, however, he says more. He says, good man, this is conferred upon you by all these Buddhas in each of the 10 directions in numbers like fine particles and 10,000 Buddha lands who bear the same name. So actually, from the support of all these Buddhas, he's able to enter this samadhi. So it's not just from his own efforts, but also because he's connected to all these Buddhas who bear the same name, who have the same name as him, that he's able to enter this samadhi. It is also due to the power of the past vows of Vairochana Tathagata. Vairochana Tathagata is the Dharma body of Shakyamuni Buddha. Vairochana Tathagata is another way of saying Buddha. Literally means thus come one or thus gone one. And how do you want to break up the Sanskrit? And it's another title of the Buddha for the Buddha, the Tathagata. And because of his past vows that his and to his spiritual strength, that he's as well as all the assembled bodhisattvas, that you can enter this samadhi and proclaim this dharma. So he has the support of the Buddhas, the Vairochana Tathagata, or the Buddha, Vairochana Buddha, as well as all the fellow assembled bodhisattvas, roots of goodness, that he can enter the samadhi and proclaim this dharma.
Okay. 像依照像我所了解的，我们在圣城受信的时候，就是沙弥，当沙弥的时候，要法师会训练一些像上台做法器呀、当维诺啊，这个佛菩萨都会加持的，因为你有这个。 执着的时候，你有这个愿力要去做的时候，佛菩萨都会加持。像这个刚才，他这个的毗卢遮那佛往昔的愿力，他都有发愿。所以，真的佛事啊，就是说你自己要想要做什么时候，你诚心都会有感应。像我们在当初在训练维摩的时候。 真的，我们都没有做过，但是你上去的时候，它自动它就会，你就自动会有那种，都像这些都是在佛菩萨在加持，而且所以很重要的，你上来这个的时候都必须要，三拜跟他最重要要尊敬他要礼拜他，然后自己要能够很诚心的，这个都会有感应的。
So here I'm reminded of during the training period when we were novices at the City of 10,000 Buddhas. We were being trained by the Dharma Masters and, for instance, the Dharma instruments and being Weino for the ceremonies. And to do that, you know, we would need to have a heart to do this job well and make a vow to really to do this job. And so with that vow and that aspiration, the Bodhisattvas come and, you could say, support or bless or give their strength as well. This is something that they would do. Whenever we want to do something with sincerity and goodness, then there's there to help support us. And so that's why, for instance, when we approach the altar, before being doing the Weino, we bow three times in a way to pay respect to them and to gain their support. Actually, this is something, I don't know if we mentioned this to our new novice, actually, Qing Xianshi. So that's why we bow, actually, for the altar. When we go to the Weino, we actually go forward. And the spirit is, you actually invite the presence and support of the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. So you're being the Weino. You're not saying, oh, how good can I sing? I can really show off how I sing. And that's that you, then you're going off. Your mind is off the wrong direction, and you're letting people off into the world of desire. And so when we're doing the service, doing the Weino, and doing that job, the idea is, how can I serve the Dharma? How can I be of service to the to the spiritual being. So here also in the sutra lecture, the same spirit, you know, when we're doing the Dharma request, we invite the presence of the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas for their spiritual support. And I hope actually if all of you who are doing the Dharma request during that time is also a really good time to invite the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas for their support, because learning the Dharma is also an active process. You actually have to like pay attention and then like think about it and then, you know, apply it into your own life and make sense of it. And so if you invite the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas to help you in that process too, then that's also a way in. So before we do Dharma activities, oftentimes if we just put our mind state, our mind, in a space of, I'm here to serve the Dharma and learn the Dharma, then it opens it to a different experience. You know, I'm not here to just get what I want and get out. You know, it's not like a product you go out and buy. You know, I'm coming here, I'm getting what I want, I'm done, I'm gone. It's okay, I'm here to be of service. And so, yeah. Okay, so before we go to the next passage, I do want to talk about this line, which is the past vows of Vairochana Buddha, or Vairochana Tathagata, because I think we often go over the word vows very quickly, which is something that is really important in Buddhism, so I don't want to just go over it, because I think there's some important principles there for our spiritual practice. There's a saying in Buddhism that says there's two powers that move us. And those two powers are karma and vows. I was just having a conversation with a layman here in the monastery earlier about it. And basically, what our lives are about is karma, which is habitual patterns, and vows, the actual aspirations that we make about what we want to do. And so if we don't make any vows, then it's all habit. So, and you could have good karma. So you can have good karma, like when you listen to the Dharma, you can just be, okay, I'm coming because my friends are here or because I have nothing to do, so I'm here, I'm going to listen to the Dharma and I go home and I just do what, you know, and just kind of follow along with your habit and just maybe end up in a good place. But actually what that does is you never actually really make headway because you're not applying yourself with a vow. So the vow is when you lay that seed, then you can start going forward. You can start moving somewhere. And so it's really, I actually think it's really important to make vows. If you're gonna, we're gonna cultivate the ways to basically look at the sutras, look at the Dharma. Here's the Avatamsaka Sutra, and we can make vows and say, oh, I am inspired by the practice, you know, this, we're gonna get to it later, which is like the first practice of the Bodhisattva. I vow to perfect the practice of happiness. You know, and that's like a vow, and that be your whole life is practicing how to be happy, you know, with the guidance from the sutras. And then you can start looking in the sutras, finding what the sutras say about happiness, because happiness isn't, you know, the Buddha doesn't say happiness comes from going to the shopping mall and buying everything that you want. So what does the Buddha say this happiness is about? And so you go and learn about it, and you practice it, and, you know, that's one vow that you can make. And every day you can make that vow in the morning when you start off, and in the evening you can reflect on it, say, so how did I do with my vow? Did I make any progress today? How did it go? And then your life actually has some direction and meaning. You know, I think that's really important, because otherwise it's just habit. And we can do a lot of good deeds in the Dharma and a lot of good deeds in the world, and it just could be from habit. And that's not bad at all. I mean, that will lead us to good places. But at the same time, that's not going to really lead ultimately to liberation in that way, because the seeds come from first planting that vow, having that Bodhi resolve. And if we make that Bodhi resolve, then this conditions, all those conditions of goodness that we're cultivating help what we make a vow about to come to fruition. So as Jing Foshu just said, when we make that vow to say, do a good job as Weino, then, or that the Weino is another, is a Chinese word for proctor, like leading the ceremonies. So when we have to like lead the ceremonies, it's called a Weino, which many of us monks didn't really expect we'd ever have to do. Like when I became a monk, I never ever, like first, when I thought about being a monk in my life before I became a monastery, I never thought I'd go chant something in front of people. It's like, I thought you go meditate somewhere in the forest or something. So, but you know, we end up doing ceremonies in the monastery, and so you want to do a good job. So if you have an aspiration, I want to do a good job, you kind of apply yourself. And then somehow things really work out because you apply yourself, and you get invisible support from other people, and you get actually, that's visible support. You get visible support from other people because you ask them for advice and they help you out. Or you get invisible support. That I don't know. But my sense is there's probably something there from some other spiritual energies that are happening. In my experiences living at the City of 10,000 Buddhas, as a layman and then as a monastic, is that what really, when real things really happen in DRBA, people, you know, in their association, we have a little bit of a reputation that things, it's really hard to do things because we're got so many different kinds of people in this organization, and it's very tricky. And so for me, actually, when I talk with people, I basically ask kind of one question. Do you have a vow to do anything? Like, do you actually have a vow? Like, you want to do something? Because my experience is when somebody actually has a real sincere vow to do something, something actually happens. That's what my experience in DRBA is. It doesn't matter all the best planning in the world, you get the most efficient idea in the whole world. If there's no real sincerity of like a vow that somebody's like, I'm going to do this, I don't care, you know, what difficulty you have to go through, I'm going to put my life on this, I'm going to work on it. And that's it. This is what I'm going to do. And that kind of, that comes out. Then something happens. Then somehow, invisibly, everything works out. And it's like, whoa, what happened? You know, it's nothing that my logical mind can really figure out. But my experience was the best planning in the world, everything seems to be working out, and it just fizzles out. It just doesn't work. So my experience has been, if I ask somebody, what's really your vow? What really you want to give your life to? And then they apply their energy there. Then what my experience has been, I really try to support that. And then the kind of things naturally work out. And so that's really what I see. Question?
What's the difference between a vow and a goal?
A vow and a goal?
Are they the same?
Are they the same or are they not? I think maybe you can first define what do you define as a goal and a vow? How would you say, what would you say a goal is? And I can see what I mean by a vow.
Aspiration, something that you're looking forward to and you...
Aspiring to?
Aspire to, yeah.
Yeah. So I think in many ways they're similar.
Goal是目标，目标就是你定自己定的一个目标，然后比较可以实行的一个目标。那愿力啊，愿是不太一样，愿就是你自己发愿。所以我们学佛人要发大愿力，像我们圣光上人是十八大愿。 要发大愿，这个愿你可以，你今生也可以，来生都可以，都会那个的。那你目标你自己目前所定的这个目标，你所看到你去执行它，这个是目标一个方式。那愿不一样，愿就是你自己心愿，你自己的心愿，你自己讲起来我们不要发小愿，要发大愿，要像。 阿弥陀佛，四十八大愿，这个就是大愿，像那个普贤十愿、恨愿品、十大愿，那个就是非常好的愿，都是讲起来都是利益众生的，不为自己，我们这个最重要的就是学菩萨道的这个一个修行的重要，自己要这样子来做。
So when you say the word goal, in Chinese it's translated usually as 目标, and something very concrete that you can kind of see before you. It's like, okay, I can do this, I'm going to set this as my goal. Vows have a kind of a different, not quite the same, they're often much greater. There's a kind of vastness to them. And so we want to make our vows great and vast. Like Merrill Master Hua, he has his 18 vows, which are very great. And then it's not just this life, we're going to make our vows for, you know, for future lives too, that's constantly. It's something that really comes from our heart. We make this kind of vast vow. We can make a vow like Amitabha Buddha, he made 48 vows. You know, they're all really great, great vows. Or Samantabhadra Bodhisattva, or University Worthy Bodhisattva, he has 10 great vows. And so those are all vows that the Bodhisattvas make, and or the Buddhas make, and they're for benefiting living beings. They're all not selfish, they're really for the welfare of all. And so that's one way of looking at goals and vows. I think if I were to maybe add something, I also see that sometimes maybe things that the vows are not, is vows aren't something that you really put on a deadline. You know, sometimes you put goals on like a deadline. If I don't do this by this time, you know, it's like, ugh. Vows are kind of got this, as Jing Foshu said, this kind of expansive quality. You're setting, literally, okay, I forgot my Sanskrit word, but I actually wrote my paper on vows in my Sanskrit class. You remember what the word is? Say again? Something like that. It starts with a P. Yeah. Pititama. So basically, I think it literally translates in Sanskrit, and if you can correct me, is setting the direction of your mind, fixing the direction of your mind. So you're basically giving your mind a direction. It's not about like, okay, I've got to do this by this certain time or else. You know, it's like, okay, you're going, okay, I'm going to go, that's why I said the practice of happiness. I'm going towards happiness in the ways that it's described, or I'm going towards precepts in a way that is described. And then so you set that direction in your mind and you can start going in that path. And the bigger it is, you can say the greater the fruition. We talked about a little bit last week about the Pali texts. You know, somebody mentioned the handful of leaves, as well as the Mahayana path, which is the four great vows of the Bodhisattva, how they're interconnected. That's really how it's connected. If you look at, what I found very interesting when I looked into the Theravada tradition is actually, you can actually see a lot of the parallels between Mahayana teachings and the Theravada teachings around the vows that the disciples made. So for instance, Shariputra, Ananda, Venerable Ananda, Venerable Maghavayana, were all the foremost disciples in, say, wisdom, spiritual powers. You know, the Venerable Ananda was the Buddha's attendant and was the best in his memory and learning. In the text, when they describe their actual lives, say how they made those vows in the past to do that. So Venerable Ananda saw a long time ago another Buddha with attendant, and saw the attendant, goes, wow, I want to be like that attendant, and had that aspiration. Then they say many eons, you know, kind of go by, and he's perfected the qualities of being an attendant to be the Buddha's attendant, in addition to realizing, you know, an arhatship. And so there's that aspiration, and it describes in the text saying he had to spend longer cultivating to perfect those virtues to become the attendant of the Buddha, right? Just so the Bodhisattva is basically spending all this time to cultivate, to perfect his virtues as well. Perfecting giving, perfecting precepts, perfecting patience, perfecting vigor, you know, concentration, wisdom, and so forth. And so that's the vow of the Bodhisattvas. Their vision is so great. So when they plant that seed, which is the seed of the Bodhi resolve, what they reap at the end of it, the fruit that they reap at the end of it is Buddhahood. So if we plant the seed of the Bodhi resolve, what we have at the end is Buddhahood. So the most important thing for us is to plant that seed. After that, it's just nurturing it because it will one day come to fruition. So I think vows are really important. You just see it coming in the Mahayana text all the time. You know, we did the Great Compassion Repentance this morning. We're making vows, right? We did the evening ceremony, we're making vows. You're doing morning ceremony, we're making, there's this vows in the ceremonies all day long in our practices, and because it's really, really important. We're setting those intentionality with our mind. So rather than just chanting it, you know, with our mouths, if we actually can get it into our hearts as well, then there's some power behind it. Yeah.
Okay. 我们在好像时间过得很快，那个就是看中间的经文了，因为菩萨给他加持，要他所以能够入这个三昧来演说这个法，那菩萨就是他自己已经修成到一种，不错的这个佛的一个境界以后，他最重要要进一步就是要能够发大悲心来度众生，用方便三巧各种的来度众生，这个就是 菩萨的一个后面他自己很重要的就是度众生的这个工作这个是一个大菩萨的话把大悲心的这个然后所以后面讲的这个为增长佛智故生智法界故总共啊一直到有十个故啊这个四个故都是为众生来做这个事情的像为增长佛智故就是像我们晚上的这个十恨品也是叫做长养十长养这个有这种的名称来称十恨品就是十长养就是要增长佛智的这个缘故 那这个他也就是为了一切众生所以上人解释啊就是这个十个缘故都是为我们一切众生来做的这个像要生日法界故就是能够所有众生能够生日法界能够知道法界一切为心造这个法界故 然后也了知众生戒故所以也是所有的众生为所有众生来了知众生的境界这个戒是境界故入所入无碍故就是能够为我们所有众生能够进入无所障碍就是他修行都能够圆满无所障碍的
Okay, so next part in the sutra, it talks about, you could say, all the reasons or motivations for why this bodhisattva, forest of merit and virtue, enters the samadhi and proclaims the dharma. And so, so what is given here is that the bodhisattva has a heart of great compassion to make vows to save living beings. So what you can see here is all of these 10 reasons are in order to help living beings. It's not for selfish reasons. And so if we look at the first one, it says, in order to grow in the Buddha's wisdom. And so this particular chapter as well, the 10 practices chapter, so sometimes also called the 10 zanyang, just the growth.
Yeah.
And growth, growing, I guess growing in the Buddha's wisdom is another way that you can describe this chapter. And for this is so that one can benefit living beings, so that all living beings can also grow in Buddha's wisdom. In order to enter deeply the Dharma realm, so living beings can enter the Dharma realm. Dharma realm is another word that we throw around a lot, which I don't know if we've ever really explained. We're called the Dharma Realm Buddhist Association, so I guess it's an important word. So maybe I'll go back to that. And then in order to understand the realm of beings, the living beings of, or you know, all living beings, so he understands their minds, so he can teach them and help them. In order to become unobstructed, so he's helping all living beings become unobstructed. Unobstructed is also kind of a funny translation. Basically, you know, when we do something and somebody gets in our way, we're obstructed, right? Or we do something and our afflictions come up and block us from doing things, we're obstructed. So the idea of unobstructedness is whenever we do everything, it's just very free and easy. It's like we're just completely free and smooth. It just goes really naturally and smoothly. So that's the state that the bodhisattva is hoping to teach living beings. He's trying to benefit them in this way. And maybe just to talk a little bit about the word Dharma realm. Dharma realm is a word that we often use. It's sometimes translated also kind of like the whole universe, you know, like the entire known universe. That's actually not completely it either, because in Buddhism, the universe is much bigger than what we usually think the universe is. If people read the kind of, like I did read science fiction and like Scientific American and
you know, all these kind of popular science, the magazine, and they talk about all the kind of new science things that are coming in, you know, about like the parallel universes, multiple dimensions, other life on other planets, and all these kind of things. And so in Buddhism, it would be interesting. I mean, it doesn't say that those things are true or not, because it doesn't really say, not that specific, like, you know, say multiple universes or alternate dimensions. But how it describes reality is that there's many, many world systems, and and there's living beings in all these different world systems who have all these different ways of seeing the world. And this just goes on limitlessly, kind of like on and on and on. And what we are is just this tiny dot on this in this universe that we're in. On this little tiny planet, and not just on this tiny planet, we're in this United States, and we're not United States, California, and then in Berkeley, and then here in Berkeley Buddhist Monastery, we're just kind of little dot, we're occupying, you know, this space. But the Dharma realm is this vast, that goes on pretty much infinitely, that in a way makes the latest science that people going out and studying actually, I say it's kind of small, but it's all within like one hair pore of the Avatamsaka spirit. You know, it's just kind of one little dot of the Avatamsaka spirit. If you imagine, it's just this vast expanse of reality. But what I really like about the Avatamsaka is that although we're just this one little dot in this kind of vast expansiveness, which sometimes we get the sense of this little bit like being futile, you know, like meaninglessness. Like I'm just a little being here in this whole universe, which is so vast, what's the purpose of my life? The Avatamsaka Sutra says that we're this little dot in this kind of little dot in this huge universe, in this Dharma realm, but that in fact, that's only because of our limited way of seeing the world. In fact, what we're, you could say, heir to is the entire Dharma realm. We're interconnected with all the universe, everything that's going on all the time. But because our consciousness and our discrimination gets so narrow and our mind gets so restricted, all we see is this, and we don't see the entirety of the Dharma realm. And so basically, in the Buddha's teachings, he's trying to open our minds up to the whole Dharma realm so that basically there's no obstruction. You know, we don't discriminate. We don't have, you know, favorites. I like this person more than this person. It's just completely expansive. Our minds are completely expansive. And I think that's possibly why, maybe one of the reasons why you could say that maybe the association has the name Dharma Realm Buddhist Association, because there's that expansive quality. And as we study the sutras, this particular sutra is seen as that sutra that really opens up to that world, you know, to that space. And so my experience with the sutras, it always kind of opens up things in my mind that I never knew had space there before. And so bit by bit, it expands out. And my experience of it is interesting, is it's not a desolate wilderness that it opens it up to, right? Which I think sometimes you can get into if you're just to study, you know, the kind of universe outside the context of the Dharma. You can find yourself just being this kind of lonely being in this empty universe, and what's the meaning to all this? What am I doing? And so the Mahayana Dharma say, yes, we're actually this little infinite little this little dot, finite dot in this infinite universe. But the problem isn't, you know, this whole universe. It's just because our mind is so limited. But if we can bit by bit let go of our attachments, we'll find our mind opens and opens and opens. Question?
Yeah? So can you say that the Dharma realm can be the same as the true essential nature of someone?
The true essential nature of someone. 听到问题吗? 他说法界可以说是人的真正的本性吗?
其实讲这个法界性, 其实你要知道, 我们常常讲, 因观法界性, 一切为心造, 那你是不是人的性呢? 他说这个问题。他说法界是不是我们的自信？你说是不是因观法界性，一切为心造？我们有这个心，才有这个法界。嗯。
Okay, apparently. Yeah. So I give all the hard questions to Jingpo.
No,
so his response is, so recite in the ceremony, we just the evening ceremony, there's that opening line for the Mongsan offering that goes, wishing now to understand all the Buddhas of the three times, contemplate the Dharma realm, everything is created from mind. The last two lines are just basically, contemplate the Dharma realm, everything is created from the mind. And so we listen to that, what do you think? What's the relationship between the mind and the Dharma realm? Because we have this mind, then we create the entire Dharma realm. So you don't have a mind, you don't have the Dharma realm. Okay. So
他的问题是说如果我们发脾气，嗔恨，是因为我们不了解吗？还是是因为我们不顺那个境界？OK，三年开始过，因为我们有无明才有发脾气，也是从无明来的，因为你不清楚、不了解，这个最重要第一个。当然你不了解，你就不知道他的 顺这个是怎么样的情况，所以，因为我们有无明，才会发脾气，这个是最重要的一个根源。So
Jing Fosher's response was, so in Master Hua's talks, he often talks about how anger comes from ignorance. Literally in Chinese, 无明, there's no understanding. So without understanding, from ignorance, we have anger. Because we don't know, but also we don't know what to do in the situation. Things come up and we don't know what to do, so we don't know how to accord with it, with principle, and so we get upset, we get angry. That's pretty good.
Yeah. And then the second question is like a request to do a review of the pure conduct.
Oh, okay. 他希望我们未来也可以那个回 去回问去看那个敬恨品，敬恨品. Yeah, that'd be good.
Yeah.
I did think about that one too. That's a really wonderful chapter.
Yeah,
that's a really wonderful chapter. The pure conduct chapter is the chapter where it talks about all the vows of the Bodhisattva. So for instance, I'm just trying to relate everything to our daily practices in the monastery. The three refuges that we do all the time, you know, to the Buddha I return and rely, that comes from the pure conduct chapter. Many of the practices as the now Qing Shenshi is now a novice monk here in the monastery, a lot of those verses that need to be memorized by novices and monks and as monastics comes from the pure conduct chapter. So when we say drink a cup of water, there's a vow that you make. When you put on your robes, there's a vow that you make. You know, when you do various things throughout the day, there's vows that you make. And that comes from that chapter. So it shows the kind of purity of heart of the Bodhisattva. The kind of mindfulness, but not in just addition to the mindfulness, he always or she always makes a vow in addition to that. So that's why it's the Mahayana. It's like you go through your daily life and you're very mindful, and in addition to mindfulness, you go, oh, I vow for all living beings that, like when we brush our teeth, you even have a vow. When I brush my teeth, I vow that living beings be harmonious and pure in mind and bite through all afflictions. That's the verse. Bite through all afflictions. Get through all your afflictions. So, okay. So yeah, we could do that in the future when we finish the 10 practices. Yeah, or we can bring some of those verses in. I think those are really great verses. So we'll finish reading this second page.
守行无障碍，就是讲我们，因为他就是为了我们一切的众生，守行就是修行，哎，
修行没有障碍，这个很重要的一点，就是我们修行假如有障碍，就不能修行，有的甚至于半路就又根本就忘了，就又回去那个跟一般的没有修行的一样啊，就是回去世俗上的那些，所以这个很重要，因为它也是为了我们一切众生所修行没有障碍，然后得无量方便故，就是说为我们一切众生能够得到无量的方便善巧的法门，因为大菩萨他真的发这个愿是很好，因为有时候我们看他我们还没有证到那个，我们看一些大菩萨所做的善巧方便，我们有时候不太清楚，所以这个他就是用这样子善巧方便来度众生的，这个是很重要的。另外就是一个收起一切自性故，所以这个收受我们一切的众生能够得到一切智，就是佛智，讲起来就是佛智。佛智它有三种，一个就是一切智、一切种智，还有一切智智，这个三种，那这个都是佛智，因为我们修行就是希望能够得到这个佛的智慧，那我们修行不会偏差，都能够正知正见，这个很重要，不会走错路，所以我们能够做很正的事情，这样子对修行很重要，所以这个是第二页，我们把它讲到这里。
So just to finish the page 2, so the next one is talk about becoming unhindered in cultivation. So this is really important because sometimes when we cultivate, we feel we get obstructed and we give up and we just go back to everyday life, mundane life, and you know, this cultivation seems too tough. Just to relate to the pure conduct chapter, there's that one verse in the pure conduct chapter. Okay, I'm pretty sure it's in the pure conduct chapter, but at least in our 53 mantras that we're supposed to recite, is it says, when I circumambulate a stupa to the right, I vow that living beings will be unobstructed in their practice, I believe, and arrive at omniscience. So it's very similar to this. And so I actually do that whenever we light these 4 incenses around here, because I kind of imagine this being like a stupa. So you can recite that verse. And so that's the spirit, is when you you cultivate, you don't want to meet obstructions, so you can keep practicing. So the Bodhisattva here basically teaches and transforms using this method, teaches how to not have obstruction in your practice. The other one is how to obtain measureless expedience. So the Buddha, Bodhisattva, is really skillful at teaching living beings. We don't even know how he's teaching us, but he knows how to teach us in ways that are inconceivable. And then order to gather back the nature of all wisdom. So this all wisdom is, you could say, the Buddha's wisdom. The Buddha has, you could say, 3 types of wisdom. In Chinese, it's one is, I think, I don't know how we would translate it. All wisdom, the knowledge of all wisdom, and how would you translate it? The knowledge of all knowledge of wisdom. So there's 3 wisdoms. You can look up in the Buddhist dictionary. There's 3 wisdoms. I actually don't really know them that well. Each it's all the wisdom of all types of wisdom, all knowledge, all modes of wisdom. So you can look that up in one of the Buddhist dictionaries, maybe, or maybe we can explain it. If people are really interested in it, we can talk about the different types of Buddha's wisdom. So that's finishing the page 2. So our time is pretty much over. I don't know if there's maybe any last questions or comments that people might have. If there's anything more online. Happy everybody was able to come out tonight. Maybe just hope people found something useful in their practice that they can use in their everyday life. So we have the transference, which is on the back of that sheet. It looks like this. And we'll have somebody accompany the on guitar. I definitely don't have that expedient skill. Oh, sorry, we should make announcements first. Okay, so we do actually have a couple announcements that are fairly important. Particularly next week, there's a weekend Amitabha session. So for the whole Saturday and Sunday, we will be reciting Amitabha Buddha's name. So that's what we'll be doing. So if people are interested in participating, we have a sign-in sheet in the back. There's also, it's on our website, berkeleymonastery.org. You can sign up there. Please let us know so we can know how much food to prepare. And also on Thursday and Friday, we'll be setting up the monastery, writing out the plaques, and getting ready, cleaning up for the ceremony. So if people would like to come, you come maybe around 1 o'clock. If you just want to come and help out, clean up and do things. So that's be this Thursday and Friday. People would like to fill out plaques, actually. Are they in the back too, or do they should come talk to you? The piano, on the piano? Okay, so on the front. Okay, so we also, people would like to write up plaques. You know, maybe somebody's sick or somebody's passed away, or you just want to send goodness to somebody. You can write, I think we were saying that you can write 2 plaques, you know, which means you can write 1 rebirth plaque or 1 long life or 2 rebirth or 2 long life at most. So we don't write like 100 plaques. So find 2 people that you really want to dedicate merit to, and you write it up, and we'll have the plaques in the session so that when we're reciting and we transfer the merit, you know, the sincerity in our hearts can help those people as well. So that's one announcement. Any other announcements? Saturday will start at 8 o'clock. We'll transmit the 8 precepts. And then after that, we'll have an orientation for English speakers, like what we did before. So I'll give a little brief explanation, and then people will start reciting here. And then this is 1 day of Amitabha recitation. And then Saturday, we're not going to transmit the 8 precepts, but we'll start at the same time and just recite. So the schedule is posted on the wall on the bulletin board, if you're interested, and also on the website.
Okay. 看一个男的，一个女的这样子，练习大家练习讲法很好，5分钟就可以了。这是法会的感想，一男一女，然后每个人讲5分钟这样子。So
Jing Forsher said that also he's hoping that next sutra lecture Saturday night, we can maybe 2 people come up, maybe 1 man, 1 woman, to just share their experiences at the session. And just for like maybe 5 minutes. My thought was, you don't want to tell them that now, then they won't come. No one shows up. We're just us 2 sitting here. What happened to everybody? Jing Forsher scared them all away. So. Yeah. Okay, yeah. Okay. Anxiety. Okay, that's one suggestion. We'll consider that. Jing Forsher, consider that. So
okay, that is a good way.
You so accepted the idea.
But I like to encourage people, you know, coming to speak. That is a venerable master. They said like a CCTV every ending. They need to talk 15 minutes, you know, 1 language. So what do we just 5 minutes?
Yeah, we won't force anybody. So please come. We won't force you. So if people would like to write their feedback, we can read it too. That'd be great.
Yeah,
so people
would
like
okay
to write
too.
Some of their feedback and experience. Yeah, that'd be a great, great thing. And maybe one more thing that I can think of is Jing Fan Shi, Dharma Master Fan, who gives the sutra lecture here, Jing Forsher and myself. We're actually going to be going to a trip to Iowa, Minnesota, and Toronto. This was planned by, I think, Jing Forsher.
And so I don't know if people know any Dharma friends there, but you can let them know we're coming. From July 23rd to August 6th. I'm not sure exactly what our schedule is, but that's happening from July 23rd to August 6th. The Jing Husher will be coming by July 21st. So we're doing like a lot of monk switching. Yeah. Okay. So any other announcements? Anything I'm forgetting? If not, Lipo can dedicate the merit to somewhere that you think needs it. There are a lot of people.
Has
one more.
因为我下礼就是我们礼拜六讲法的时候，我会放一些影片，就是说我们 BBM 的一些活动，像夏天来的活动，就是还有写日的，还有那个 outreach 的，我想给大家看一下。 这个就是鼓励大家能够尽量参与我们的这些这也是算一种结缘弘法，做佛弟子的尽量来做。像我们都做过两次，在佛诞的时候，就是一佛节，还有神功上人涅槃纪念的时候，我们都有做 Mr. Yap 还有我们的这个 Susan 还有都我看大家都有去，我想给大家看一下，还有我们书法的，也看一下我们书法的成果，这个都很好，因为有大家没有白努力，大家只要努力就有成果，这个是很好的。
So next time, Jingfo will also show some pictures of the various activities in the monastery. We have calligraphy class. We have various things with the outreach group at the 7,000 Buddhas at various Dharma assemblies. So all your efforts and your participation are not in vain. They're all part of your spiritual practice. And so we'll show some of the pictures to share with everybody. Okay. No more last things? Okay. So please make your wish and dedicate the merit.
So if we can all stand and bow to the Buddhas.